Welcome to my YouTube channel. On Facing the Canon, we welcome back the two amazing, inspiring women, Marilyn Baker and Tracy Williamson. It is a great joy to welcome you both back to Facing the Canon. Welcome, Marilyn Baker. Welcome, Tracy Williamson, to Facing the Canon.
Oh, it's fantastic to be here.
Yes, good to be here with you.
Now, Marilyn, you are a trustee of the Torch Trust. Tell us about that.
Well, the Torch Trust for the Blind, they are a wonderful organisation. We're like a sort of family together, really. And they produce amazing literature in accessible formats like in Braille and very large print and things like that. We also do programming on the RNIB Connect radio program and podcasts. There's a podcast going on at the moment called Sight Loss 101, and it's all about how people often, they find faith, perhaps when they're coming to their lowest point, when they've had a diagnosis of sight loss or something, and how they cope with sight loss. So really, we're all about bringing people into the church more and more who have got sight loss and who need extra help. Things like seeing stuff on the screen, and they can't, obviously, so what do you do about that? And just befriending folk, because blind people have got a tremendous amount to give, like all disabled people. They're not just there to be looked after. They can contribute in the body of Christ.
Absolutely. And Tracy, you're involved in a different charity for those who are deaf. Tell us about that.
Well, it's called Open Ears, and used to be the Hard of Hearing Christian Fellowship. And it's really to serve people that have all degrees of hearing loss, and especially those that have become deaf, who weren't born deaf as such, but who acquired deafness maybe through illness, and like myself. And so it's to provide fellowship and encouragement. I mean, it's very hard for deaf people in church because most people can't hear what's being said. Even notices and things like that go completely over a person's head, let alone the depths of the sermon and everything like that.
And prayer time, isn't it, as well?
So we're trying to provide conferences and fellowship and encouragement for those with hearing loss across the country.
It's wonderful to hear about both of those charities, and want to encourage any of our viewers that need further help or encouragement or fellowship to look into those charities, and I'm sure you'll receive the encouragement that you need. Thank you. Marilyn, how did the two of you meet?
Well, it was amazing. Tracy was working at a college, at Chorley Wood College, actually, doing some work experience, and a blind friend who lived with me came to the college to take the Christian Union and met Tracy there. And she said, "Do you want to come and have a meal?" Trace was a bit down at the time. She thought her deafness was a problem working with the blind children, which it had been. And so she came to our house and had a meal, but I wasn't there at the time. And then she said, "Do you want to come again and meet Marilyn?" Well, of course, Trace had heard of me, but not a lot, because I'm not, obviously Trace didn't listen to music that much. And so she was a bit kind of in awe of meeting me like a gospel singer. I was already kind of on the road. And I had decided at the time that I wanted to do something good with my hair. And I'd read about putting henna on it. And they used to do it in the Bible. So I thought, I'm going to put henna on my hair. And I did, but I'd forgotten this Tracy was going to arrive, and I had this on my hair. But when Trace arrived, when Trace came, she was really shocked, because I came down the stairs and I was, looking like I had, got blood on me.
Her friend answered the door and invited me in and said, "Marilyn's not quite ready." And so I went in and I was taking my jacket off. Heard something on the stairs and looked up, and Marilyn was coming down, and she looked like something out of a horror film.
Yes,
her face was covered in blood.
Yeah, you thought because it was all this
red dye.
Yeah, red dye. So that was funny. And, you know, she ended the whole evening getting the dye off my bathroom and off me.
You became friends and you became partners in ministry.
Yes, that was amazing. Because we never expected that at all. I was interviewing people to join me. I'd lost my assistant at the time, she'd resigned, and Trace was helping me interview people, and I couldn't find anybody to travel on the road with me. Obviously, I needed a guide and a helper. And I said to Trace, well, as I can't find anyone, would you like to come along with me just to give me a hand with packing and doing the ironing and making me look nice and all that kind of thing, just till we find the right person? But because Trace was deaf, we never really thought that she would actually be that person, because she avoided public appearances and, you know, wasn't her thing to be with audiences. But at the time, we went to a concert together, and I remember feeling I had a big program to do, and I said, would you like to speak, Trace? Could you give your testimony? She didn't even know what that was, really, but she thought about it and told her faith story. And it was amazing, wasn't it, Trace, that first concert we did?
Yes, yes. Well, as Marilyn said, she'd asked me to share it, which I'd never done. And at this point, I've been a Christian about 18 months.
Yes.
And I was literally so scared. I was shaking when she called me up to the mic. And not being able to hear, I didn't know how people gave testimonies. Or what kind of thing they should. And so it was completely out of my comfort zone. And I had no idea what to say. And I got to the mic and I just said, Lord, please help me. And suddenly I was just so aware of his presence, as if he was standing right next to me. And this amazing peace came over me. And I started to share about my childhood and some of the things that I shared earlier about the despair I'd felt, and how I became a Christian, and how he was starting to heal my life and pour his love. And it was an ongoing process, but it was just this amazing sense of fluency that I didn't know how to put words together before, but suddenly the words were coming. And
it was amazing, because a lot of people, it was like you could hear a pin drop in a room. And I think it was like 12 people rededicated their lives to the Lord again,
wonderful.
And eight people became Christians that night.
Yes.
And I sang my song, He Gives Joy, after she gave her testimony. And I said to Trace, you have got something so special about your life. I said, you don't think you can speak, you don't think you're a public figure. I said, but you've got a real anointing, an ability from God to speak words that will touch hearts. And so we decided to come together.
And how long ago was that, Marilyn?
Well, I should think we've been together now. How long, Trace? About 35 years, is it? Something like that, you know. If time just flies.
Yes. And you've been partners in ministry. Let's go back to the beginning for you, Marilyn. You're obviously a very capable musician, very gifted. You were teaching the oboe in several schools. But then you felt... And you started writing your own gospel songs and singing them. And then you felt this call to go full time in ministry.
Yeah, that was
Tell us about that.
That was a struggle because I'd done my first album, He Gives Joy, and it sold very well. And then the record company people came to see me and they said, we think you should be praying about giving up your teaching job and going into this music ministry full time. And I thought, you must be joking. You know, I thought, I'm not going to do that. It'd take me a long time already to get a teaching practice going in different schools. And so they said, well, will you at least pray about it? But I thought, well, I know the answer. I'm not going to give it up, you know? But anyway, I thought I would pray about it. Perhaps
yes.
I should. And as I did, I was shocked. Every single excuse I was making or reason why I truly thought it wasn't wise, God seemed to take from under my feet. And I mean, for instance, there was a girl that I was teaching the oboe to, and she was so gifted. I'd promised her parents to get her into college, music college, no matter what. And she came to me one week and she said, I'm going to give up the oboe. I was so shocked. She said, I've decided I want to study medical things and yes. I want to be a doctor. Well, all the other things I thought about, my parents were against it, everything, but I decided in the end to take that jump. And I mean, I wasn't well known, I didn't have loads of bookings, and where would the money come from? I had no idea. I spoke to my pastor and he said, go for it, Marilyn. We think you've got a gift and God wants to use it. And I just did. I left my job. And 2 days after leaving it, I had a phone call, or rather the person helping me with bookings did, saying, would Marilyn go to New Zealand to yes. sing? I was amazed. I thought no one had ever heard of me in there.
So you went to New Zealand and Australia, didn't
I did.
You?
I did. It was just staggering. And you know, a friend came with me and we had the most amazing time there. Incredible.
So, and the two of you have been ministering together all over the place. And you both... music, worship, teaching. And Tracy, you've written a number of books. Here I've got A Beautiful Tapestry. Tell us what this book's about, Tracy.
Yes. So A Beautiful Tapestry is a latest book, and it's our story together. We both wrote it. But Marilyn didn't want to do the main writing, so she shared her ideas and her memories and send them to me as an email, and I tried to put them together in a flowing way. And then I did my own, and we wanted it to be real, because sometimes people put those who are kind of travelling around and doing things up on a pedestal.
Yes.
But we're certainly not on a pedestal. I mean, no. We have all sorts happen, and we lose our tempers, and we get kind of stuck in daft situations with the hearing and eyesight business.
Absolutely.
We wanted to share the weak moments and the joys and the sadnesses.
Absolutely. And what about this one, The Father's Kiss? What's that about, Tracy?
Yeah, this one came actually after I'd had a period of feeling that I couldn't write anymore. And then God put this thought on my heart, I want you to write about my love. I want you to write about the Father's kiss. And it was really all to do with the father and the prodigal son's story, and how he ran to his son and embraced him and lavished love on him and kissed him when that son had messed up in life so much. And really the book evolved out of that, and how deeply God has been loving me as a father. Despite my lack of father experience
yes.
in life.
It's got beautiful stories of affirmation about how God wants to love each one of us and how we can sort of enter into it. So it's a very upbuilding book.
And despite how our human fathers may have not been the good model and example that they should have been to us, our Heavenly Father, as the psalmist says, he's like a father to us. Mm. Tender and sympathetic, and high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love. Marilyn, so you started writing songs, you've released a couple of albums. I mean, you've been doing this, so here's the ultimate collection.
Yes, that's right.
I mean, obviously, you've been singing for 40 years.
I have, yes, and we had a launch time for that. And you know, it's been an amazing time. You see, my heart has always been, perhaps because I am blind, you know, there are sort of areas of life where I need to ask God for help. Perhaps where some people may not, like when you lose things on the floor or just finding your way or crossing a road, whatever it might be, I'm talking to him about all these things, and I'm hearing often his answers or his help. I'm hearing his wonderful affirmations of love in my heart, and I think there's so many that need to know how God loves them. And so in the songs, I try to put teaching in the songs, and I try to put comfort in the songs, comfort that will really reach into hearts. Because I think that music can actually be a wonderful way of conveying beautiful words. Music brings atmosphere into the words. And there's one song I remember writing because a couple had lost their only son in our church and they were utterly heartbroken, and I was for them. And I remember saying to God, what can I do, Lord? What can I say to them? He said, write this song. And the words were things like, I will never leave you, I'll never forsake you. My arms of love are all you need at this time. And I thought, thank you, Lord, you can give me words like this with a melody that will kind of bring hope and restfulness into their souls.
Absolutely. Well, last night, Marilyn, Killy and I were listening to you on Alexa. We said to Alexa, play Marilyn Baker, and she did. And it was just letting the truth of the words just wash into us was very good. I know you don't have your, you play oboe, you play the keyboard.
Yes, I do. I play keyboards and piano and stuff like
that. Piano, yeah. But are you able to sing us a song even though you haven't got your piano
here?
I can,
actually. I'll sing one.
Would you do that?
I will. Right, this one's called Hollow of His Hand, okay? I'm held in the hollow of his hand. That's where I am. That's where I am. I'm held in the center of his love. That's where I am. That's where I am. Well, the Lord loves to show us just how much he loves us. Then our fears and our doubts just melt away. I'm held in the hollow of his hand forevermore. Yes, for eternity.
Beautiful, beautiful.
There you are.
That was beautiful, Marilyn. Wow. That really warms the heart.
I want songs to warm the heart. I want people to know that God is for them, not against them, that God's Holy Spirit will show us the things we need to know, and he's living not just with us, but when we're Christians, he's living deep inside of us, and he wants to communicate God's very thoughts, his very heart to us. And that's what he's done for me so many times, and I want to pass on that kind of beautiful affirmation and comfort from God to others.
Beautiful, Marilyn. So good. Tracy, what do you sense the Lord is saying to the church today?
Well, I sense that he has a deep longing in his heart for people to discover his Father love and how kind of personal and real he is. And that he really wants to be alongside people. And as we travelled here for this interview today, I had a sense that someone felt very small, almost like an ant in size, scurrying along, invisible to everyone, easily trampled underfoot. And it was such a sense of kind of being nothing, being unseen, not mattering. And then it was as if I could sense the Lord's heart saying, I love you so much. And if only you could see yourself as I see you. I'm carrying you with joy upon my shoulders. You are my beloved child. I never turn my back on you. You matter so much to me that I'm into the cross for you. I want to give you everything to lavish my love on you. And I hope that you, if you're listening now to that and you're feeling that, that you'll really take that love in. Mm. But in an overall sense, this is what I sense from him, that he longs to kind of draw people into his embrace.
Yes.
And really lavish his love on them and build them up and heal the hurts of their lives.
Yes.
By his Father love.
Thank you, Tracy.
It's his sort of affirmation and his beautiful heart for us that brings such healing, isn't it?
It's fascinating with the two of you that your disabilities have not hindered you in any way. What would you say, Marilyn, to anyone listening now, viewing now? You know, maybe they have disabilities, but they know the Lord's calling them into ministry. I mean, I know we're all in ministry, but you stepped out. What would you say to people who are a little bit fearful about stepping out in serving God when they're very aware of restrictions?
I would say it's natural to be afraid. I certainly did feel afraid. I wondered how I was going to do it. I knew that I would need someone to travel with me, to be alongside me humanly. And God provided all that. If God is calling you, He's also going to provide the resources you need. That might be different sorts of support you need. But if He's calling you, He will provide it. And there's no doubt about that. You know, He'll give you all the help you need. I mean, I remember thinking, you know, I need to make, in those days, it was a record. And I thought, how am I going to do that? I've got no idea how to even begin such a thing. And suddenly I met up with someone who knew someone who owned a record company. And when I recorded my very first record in those early days, the company director didn't really believe that my record was going to be that good, so he hadn't put much money into it. But after we'd done the first recording, he came to me personally, apologised for his initial lack of interest and offered to become my manager. And he launched me into what I was doing, him and his wife. They gave me so much in the end, but I couldn't make that happen. It was God that kind of made that process happen. So I believe that if you step out, if you believe it's God, test it out with others, ask people about your gifts and what they feel as well, and then trust in God's anointing and go for it, because you'll get what you need.
Wonderful. Tracy, you're a speaker, teacher. Share with us a reflection of something that the Lord has been putting on your heart recently.
Well, I was thinking about the resurrection. With Easter having just gone by, I've been writing encouragements for him, our Facebook page. And I was thinking about Jesus. And when he rose and met Mary at the tomb, she was at a point of such despair and couldn't see any hope for the future. And there's something about when we're in a place of despair that makes us not able to see or not recognise the good things that are around. And so we meet many people that are kind of not able to see or believe that God could love them, or even see that life can be wonderful in different ways, because they're so kind of despairing inside. And that was what Mary was feeling. This is what I was reflecting on. When Jesus met her, and she was thinking he was a gardener, because she just couldn't see out of that despair. But then he spoke her name. And there was that sudden moment of kind of recognition. And that's a wonderful thing, I find, that when he comes to us and he kind of does something or shows us something, and he always knows how to get through to where we are. With me, it was that girl at the college in the very first instance, saying that God had spoken to her when I was at that point of such despair myself. And yet just within those few days, hearing God, that student did, to tell me that God loved me and he knew the way to my heart. And so I just started to say that for all of us, he knows the way to our hearts. And it can come to us in a way that we will recognise and kind of warm to on the inside. My way might be quite different to Marilyn's. And I might be moved in a moment by something really beautiful that I see, like a landscape. Or Marilyn, by by a beautiful piece of music, but equally by cream cake or something like that. But basically, the Lord is a friend.
Absolutely.
And he loves to come to us as a friend in that way.
And what a friend we have in Jesus.
Yes.
Isn't that true, Marilyn?
Absolutely.
Marilyn, we can't finish the programme without having one more song from you. Go on, sing us one more.
Okay, then. Well, I'll just sing the chorus of the first song that I sang in that concert with Tracy that time. He gives joy to the hopeless, peace to the weary, and he binds up the broken-hearted. Did you know there's someone who can hear your faintest sigh? Someone who can hear your heart's deepest cry? He's the one who made you. He knows you through and through. So give him a chance and let his love shine through. He gives joy to the hopeless, peace to the weary, and he binds up the broken-hearted.
Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful, Marilyn. This is my book, Jesus Christ, the Truth, okay? And I'm going to give that one to Tracy. Now, you read Braille, don't you, Marilyn?
I do, actually,
so,
yes.
So, look at this. I've got it in Braille.
Oh, how exciting!
I know. So,
wow!
So, this is it for Tracy. There you are. And oh, here wow. you are in Braille.
Oh, wow, I'm so excited. But see how many volumes
Look, it's four volumes.
Wow, four volumes of Braille, and I shall jolly well enjoy it.
It's all about
all
Jesus.
About him. Yeah.
And you two exude Jesus. You're like Batman and Robin. Oh, there used to be a programme on television, Cagney and Lacey. I'm trying to think of an equivalent. But you're two amazing angels. And it was lovely to hear a little of your story. And we pray God's continued well-being for you both, preservation, and may his favor continue to shine on you both and through you. Thank you so much, Marilyn and Tracy, for joining us on Facing the Canon.
It's been a thrill to be with you, John. We've loved it.
Thank you.
Well, honestly, talk about a heartwarming program with two wonderful women who exude the presence of God. I really hope that this has inspired you. I hope it's encouraged you. I hope it's infused in you a little bit more faith and hope and love. Thank you for joining us on Facing the Canon.